श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः, श्री परम गुरुभ्यो नमः, श्रीमदानंद तीर्थ भगवत्पादाचार्येभ्यो नमः। हरि ओम। निखिलगुणनिकायं नित्य निर्धूतहेयं शुभतमतिमेयं शुद्धसख्य प्रतिपायं सकलनिगमगेयं सर्वशब्दाभिधेयं नवजलधरकायं नौमि लक्ष्मीसहायं विघ्नौघवारणं सत्याशेष विश्वस्य कारणं करुणासिन्धुं आनन्दतीर्थबन्धुं हरिं भजे। अभ्रमभङ्गरहितमजनं विमलं सदा आनंदतीर्थमतुलं भजे। तापत्रयापहं चित्रैपदिश्च गंभीरैर्वाक्यैर्मानैरखण्डितैः गुरुभावं व्यञ्जयन्ती भाति श्रीजयतीर्थवाक् समुत्सारतमस्तोमं सन्मार्गं सम्प्रकाश्य च सदा विष्णुपदासक्तं सेवे ब्रह्मण्यभास्करं ज्ञानवैराग्यभक्त्यादिकल्याणगुणशालिनः लक्ष्मीनारायणमुनिन्वन्दे विद्यागुरुद्भव श्रीमद्वशास्त्रदुग्धाब्धिं धीमन्तरमहीभृत आमत्रोद्धृते न्यायामृतमिव तत्प्रत्यये विक्षिप्तसङ्ग्रहात् क्वापि क्वाप्युक्तस्योत्पादनात् अनुक्तकथनात् क्वापि सफलोऽयं श्रमो मम। अर्थकल्पितकल्पोऽयं प्रत्यर्थगतकेसरी व्यासतीर्थगुरुर्भूया तस्मदिष्टार्थसिद्धे भक्तानां मानसाम्बोजभानवे कामधेनवे भजतां कल्पतरवे जयिन्दगुरवे नमः। श्रीगुरुभ्यो नमः। द न्यायामृत इस ए मैग्नम ओपस वर्क by Shri Vyastirtha. Out of the many works of Shri Vyastirtha, the three great works have been hailed as the highest achievement in Indian philosophy. And those works are namely the Tatpari Chandrika, the Nyayamrita and the Tarka Tandava. The Nyayamrita examines many schools of thought, particularly the idealistic school, and brings out a strong contrast of the realistic school in that regard. It very judiciously and with reason shows how the rigorous stand of realism alone is justified in philosophical thinking. The Nyayamrita is divided into four parichedas or sections. Such a division is quite apt in keeping with the division of the Brahma Sutras. The Brahma Sutras are also divided into four chapters: Samanvayadhyaya, Avirodhadhyaya, Sadhanadhyaya and Phaladhyaya. The first adhyaya deals with the culmination of all auspicious qualities in Brahman or Vishnu. The second adhyaya, the Avirodhadhyaya, deals with the removal of blemishes. The third adhyaya deals with the sadhana or the means to liberation. And the fourth adhyaya, the Phaladhyaya, deals with the nature of liberation. Following this seems master structure proposed by Badarayana Vyasa, Sri Vyastirtha frames the work Nyayamrita in the same regard. Although the Nyayamrita doesn't go as a commentary directly upon the Brahma Sutras, nevertheless, the schemata of the Brahma Sutra has been adopted here very subtly. So, In the first Paricheda, the reality and other things are defined, and thereby establishing the auspicious nature of Brahman. In the second Adhyaya, we find the removal of doubts and difficulties. So in that Dvitiya Paricheda, we find a very important section called as the Vishesha Samarthanam. It is the justification of the concept of Vishesha, which is so special to the Dvaita school of Vedanta. Any reader of Indian philosophy will be acquainted with the word Vishesha, but however, it would be in the context of Nyaya Visheshika school. Dravya Guna Karma Samanya Vishesha Samvaya Bhava Sapta Padartha is the most oft-quoted line, which may be very familiar to any student of Indian philosophy, and thereby the Vishesha noted there would be taken as an intrinsic quality which differentiates one atom or paramanu from the other. However, in the context of Dvaita Vedanta, the word Vishesha doesn't actually go with that meaning. Rather, it is a special concept of Dvaita Vedanta. Among the many concepts of the Dvaita school of thought, the Vishesha concept is also a very important one. Just like the Sakshi, the metaphysical stature of difference or bheda, the power of the upajivya pramana, and many other concepts. Similarly, the concept of vishesha is very unique and special to the Dvaita school of Vedanta. In fact, it is one of the many singular contributions of Srimadhacharya to the world of philosophy. In this regard, we find a very important discussion in the Nyayamrita, followed by its explanation in the Laghva Moda by Sri Vijayendra Tirtha. So to look at some of the salient features of this particular concept and how it has been dealt in the Nyayamrita, we may have to take up the development of the concept in the Nyayamrita textually. So the Nyayamrita begins with the explanation of Vishesha. Vastutastu asmanmate bhedo vastuna savishesha bhinnaha. The question here is, naturally, in the flow of the text of Nyayamrita, in the previous section, the concept of difference was taken. The concept of difference was taken. And there may be a natural question in that regard, whether the difference is also different from the substratum or not. In fact, among the many of the metaphysical concepts of realism questioned by the idealistic school, the concept of difference is also one which is being objected many times. In many of the previous texts to Nyayamrita and even to the post-Nyayamrita texts, we find certain objections to the concept of reference. The Nyayamrita clears all those objections actually. One of the objections may go in this way. Whether the difference in a substratum or in the locus, is that different from the locus or is it identical with the locus? It's an important question there. It's a metaphysical question. For example, the pot is different from the cloth. The pot is different from the cloth. The difference of the cloth exists in the pot. Now, whether this difference as a concept, is it identical with the locus, the pot, or is it different from it, is the question. At the first instance, it looks like it is different from the locus because we say that difference exists in the pot. That is how we make connotation of it. The difference exists in the pot. We know that. So when we say something exists in another thing, those two things have to be different. So now, when we say the difference exists in the locus, it means to say the difference is something different and the locus is different from it. So therefore, there is one more difference between the difference in the pot. Again, the same question returns with a much vigor. Whether this difference is again identical with the locus or not. Since we have made the habit of accepting the difference as different from the locus, we will be again forced by the same habit to say the second difference, to name it as so, is also different from the locus. So again, that invokes a third difference. The same question returns back, boomerangs back. And a fourth difference is postulated and it goes on and on ad infinitum. It leads to infinite regress. It leads to accepting of infinite concepts to explain the simple phenomenon that the pot is different from the cloth. So to explain the simple phenomenon, which is very well established in the finite mind, as the cloth is different from the pot, we are forced to accept n number of differences. The differences ontologically as a concept as well. This is infinite regress fallacy or anavastha dosha. This cannot be entertained because to explain a simple phenomenon, if we are accepting infinite concepts, it is much beyond the scope of any science or shastra always tried to explain the phenomenon in a finite way, not in an infinite way rather. The explanation of infinity is only with regard to the Brahman and not to any other things. And even if it is with regard to other things, they have to be factually established and not assumed. But here, it's an assumed infinity. That the difference invokes another difference, and that the difference invokes another difference. It's an invoked infinity which is not teethable. What is teethable is that which is only established by means of knowledge. Anything that is not accepted or established by the means of knowledge will lead to, if at all, it leads to infinite chain. It is infinite regress or anavastha. To clear this doubt, Sri Vyastirtha says that the concept of course, there is one more thing, that the concept of difference is identical with the locus, because that is the only option left. To avoid infinite regress, we may have to say that the difference is identical with the locus. In this case, the question actually crops up here. If at all the difference is actually identical with the locus, what sort of identity is that? Well, anyway, that's a question from the side of Dvaita Vedanta, which will be answered by themselves, by ourselves. That this identity is technically called as Savishesha Abheda. Abheda refers to identity, but it is not just pure identity or Kevala Abheda, but it is Savishesha Abheda. That is an identity which coexists with the something called as Vishesha. And what is Vishesha? We'll explain it. So, if there is any identity with special, with the Vishesha, it is called as Savishesha Abheda. That exists between the difference and the locus. So the difference and the locus are identical, but they are identical in terms of being together with Vishesha, Savishesha Abheda. So here the infinite regress is cut, because when it is held as identical, of course it's a kind of identity called as Savishesha Abheda, but nevertheless it's identity. When identity is being asked, is accepted, there is no scope for infinite regress, because that doesn't involve another difference, and that doesn't involve another difference, and it doesn't go on in that way. The chain is cut in the first instance itself, that it is identity. So therefore, there is no scope for infinite regress. However, this has to be further explained, because if it is pure identity or pristine identity, that is Atyanta Bheda or Kevala Bheda, then there would be many problems, because we are using two words. We are using the word difference, and we are also using the word ghata or the locus. So when the two different words are employed, how can identity be invoked? So that would be a problem. So therefore, total identity or complete identity, Atyanta Veda, is not accepted here, but it is Savishesha Veda. It's identity, no doubt, but it is together with the element of Vishesha. So now the anavastha doesn't happen. Ataha vastu tastu asminna asman mate bhedo vastuna savishesha bhinnaha. The difference bheda is savishesha bhinna. It is identical together with speciality in the locus vastuna, in the vastu. That is the standard of Dvaita Vedanta. So therefore there is no infinite regress. That is being said. Tatascha Abhinnatvat na anavasthadi iti. So therefore, since it is identical, there is no scope for anavastha or infinite regress, as noted earlier. However, what is this called? What is this concept called as Vishesha? When we say Savishesha Bheda, what does it mean? So now, before explaining that concept, we have to take note of how Laghva Bodha very actively contributes to the arguments and the lines of Sri Vyastirtha's Nyayamrita. The Laghva Bodha remarks at the very outset, Nanu Swarupa Bheda Pakshona Yuktaha Bheda Ghata Shabda Yoho Pariyayata Pattehe Yekatara Parishesha Pattescha Ityashinkyaha. it has been noted in this way. If at all, the difference is the very nature of that locus are identical with the locus, there are certain difficulties. First of all, if the difference is held as identical with the locus, then why are we using the two words? We are using the word ghata or even ashraya or locus, and at the same time we are also using the word difference or bheda. If at all this difference or bheda is totally identical with the locus, then there shouldn't have been two different words at all. But however, we used two different words like ghata, and we also use another word like bheda. So therefore, when we are using two words which are not synonyms, essentially the thing that is denoted by them has to be different. But however, the school of Dvaita Vedanta is holding it as identical, so it cannot be total identity or it cannot be pristine identity. And further, if both of them are identical, only one has to be named or remained. Either we have to maintain the locus alone, or we may have to maintain the difference alone, not both. But however, in our general experience, we take note of both the locus as well as the difference. So therefore, how can pristine identity or kevala bheda be entertained is the question. The answer to that is, it is savishesha bheda and not tadvinta bheda. It is an identity together with the concept of vishesha. So that is the answer actually very actively given by the Lambhamoda of Shivajindra Tirtha. If we don't realize this particular important question raised and answer given by Shivajindra Tirtha, we will not be able to move further the explanation of the lines of Nyayamata. So the commentary is quite indispensable. So the avastha is cut short. And what do you mean by Vishesha here? And then what is the utility of that Vishesha concept? Bheda Pratinidheshya Visheshasya Satvan Na Paryayatvadikam. Naturally, the question will be, if difference or Bheda is identical with the locus, say the Ghata, then why are we using two different names? In the first instance, we name it as the locus Adhara or Ghata, and later we also take note of the word difference or bheda. Why are we using two non-synonyms here? If they are identical, synonyms should have been used, but we are not using synonyms. That clearly shows it is different. So the difference is different from the locus, and again it invokes a difference, and that difference is again different from locus, and the infinite always goes on. How do you avoid it is the question. So now it has been said, Bheda Pratinidheshya Visheshasya Satvanna Paryayatvadikam. Here, the question would have been, it should have been synonymous. Both the locus as well as the difference should have been synonyms. I mean, the word locus as well as the word difference should have been synonyms. But however, they are not synonyms. Doesn't it show a difference between those two is the question, but not so, because you would explain it in this way. Sometimes, even though there is identity, two words would be used not as synonyms but as different. How is it possible? It is possible with the concept of Vishesha. Bheda Pratinidheshya Vishesha Satvat. Vishesha is a concept which when we deeply think of, is it stays in a particular locus and also executes the task of difference. So, whenever there is a difference in locus, difference as an attribute, it would do many things. It would establish the pot and others as different from this, or rather the cloth and others as different from this. So, whatever that is done by actual difference or Veda, if the same thing is achieved by another entity, that particular concept is called Vishesha, which actually stays as a substitute for actual difference. It is, as the word substitute is a loose term, but rather it's an alternate option to connote something as different from something, although there is identity. So although there is identity, we can make note of difference between two things by the power of something called as Vishesha or the Vishesha concept. So therefore, here we can very clearly say the Vishesha concept actually as a concept stays in a particular locus and executes a task of difference, actual difference. Bheda Pratinidhi, that's exactly why the Vishesha is hailed as Bheda Pratinidhi. So therefore, there is no Paryaya Padika. So therefore, we cannot say the words should have been synonymous, because using two words as not synonymous is actually one form of Bheda Vivahara. Rather, it's a connotation of difference. However, there is no actual difference. It's identity together with the power of Vishesha, and that gives rise to a notion as if it is different. Well, that notion if it, as if it is different is actually an illusion, but however, many people would realize that it is actually identical, but they would also search for the concept of Vishesha. So therefore, there is no branding all our experiences as illusions. So now, Visheshascha Bhedahine Api Yekatar Parishesha Bhavadi Nirvahakaha. So the question, the concept of Vishesha is also explained in this way. Even though there is no difference or Bheda, Bhedahina, that is, even though there is no difference, even though there is identity, Yekatar Parishesha Bhava, it will give rise to the situation of not maintaining a single entity. To illustrate it with an example, the difference is actually identical with the locus, but however, it doesn't, since there is a Vishesha, the concept of Vishesha is present there, even though there is no difference between those two attributes, whether the difference in locus, Ekatar Parishesha Bhava, this particular Vishesha will not make us to isolate only one thing as identical. Although there is identity, it doesn't boil down to a single entity, but rather to the connotation of two simple things, two things. It's just a connotation that is forged by the concept of Vishesha. And that is being spoken of here. And Sri Vyastirtha quotes a work here, verse, Bhedahine tu aparyaya shabdantara niyamakaha Vishesho nama kathitaha sosti vastu shvasheshataha. So what is Vishesha concept? Even though there is no difference between two things, Bheda, that would actually give rise to, when there is no difference, it give rise to total identity, apparently, and all the words that is denoting a single entity should have been similar, synonyms. But however, since there is a concept of Vishesha there, the conceptual Vishesha, it will not make it identical with that thing, but rather, it's an identity, no doubt, but however, there will also be a tint of connotation of difference rather, or the effect of difference. So that is the concept of Vishesha here. And that is being explained very well in the Amoda of Lagvamoda of Sri Vijayanatha Tirtha. With respect to the concept of Vishesha, Sri Vyastirtha points out that such a concept has to be invariably admitted in all schools of philosophy, including the idealistic school. The concept of Vishesha goes in this way. Even when there is an identity, at times there would be a connotation of difference. Rather, the effect of difference is perceived. The so-called effect of difference. Normally, in the world, there are certain effects of difference which are seemingly produced by difference. But however, they may be even produced by identity as well. And what gives the power to that identity to produce the seemingly effects of difference? That is Vishesha. So put it in simple terms, when the Vishesha or the power of Vishesha exists in a thing, even though it is having identity, it produces an effect of difference, a connotation of difference at times. It behaves as if there is difference, seemingly, apparently. Or rather, it produces the effect where the difference would have produced it. That is called as Vishesha. And all schools of philosophy invariably have to accept it. And even the idealistic school. For that, Sri Vyastirtha shows an Arthapatti. It's a form of inference. wherein it is invariably, it, we have to invariably accept that there is something called as Vishesha. And to point out that, Sri Vyasatirtha takes up a Shruti passage, Vijnanam Anandam Brahma. In this particular passage, Brahman is pointed out as having the nature of Vijnanam, right knowledge, and Ananda, bliss. So literally, the sentence speaks out in this way. The right embodiment of right knowledge, or the embodiment of special right knowledge, and this is Brahman. This is the intention of the passage. However, here the question would be, even to the idealistic school, is the right knowledge and bliss identical with Brahman, or is it different from Brahman, or is it both identical and different from Brahman? Three stands can be proposed. I mean, there are only three alternatives. When it says Vijnanam Anandam Brahma, right knowledge and bliss is Brahman, whether that right knowledge and bliss is the actual nature of Brahman identical with him or with it, or is it different from it, or it is both different and identical with it, Bhinnabhin, are the options. We'll keep the first option aside. The second option is, it should be treated as different. However, it cannot be treated as different in the idealistic school, because the idealistic school advocates a theory called Akhandartha Nishtatva of the great Vedic passages. The great Vedic passages, which are held as Tattva Vedaka, or which speaks about valid knowledge, or which speaks about the true nature of Brahman, are always Akhandartha Nishta. That is, they speak about only the nature of Brahman. They do not speak of anything else. They do not speak of anything else apart from Brahman. That is the Akhandartha Nishtatva of the great passages of Vedanta. Akhandartha Nishtatva literally points out that the Vedic passages speak only about the nature of Brahman. In that case, Vijnanam Anandam Brahma is a great Vedic passage, which is accepted by the idealistic school as speaking only the nature of Brahman and nothing else. But however, now, as we had questioned, whether the right knowledge and bliss is of the nature of Brahman or not. If it is held that it is different from the nature of Brahman, if it is held that it is different from the nature of Brahman and not identical with Brahman, then the great Vedic passage Vijnanam Anandam Brahma speaks about three things there. Then it speaks about Vijnana, that is right knowledge, it speaks about Ananda or bliss, and it also speaks about Brahman. As the alternative goes, since their right knowledge and bliss are held to be different from Brahman, it should be speaking about things which are different from Brahman, because the right knowledge and bliss are other than Brahman, and the Vedic passage speaks about it. So therefore, it speaks of nature which is other than Brahman, Vijnana and Ananda, which is other than Brahman. So therefore, it speaks about things which are different from Brahman. Therefore, it cannot be held as Akhandartha Nishta. It goes against the theory of the idealistic school that the great passages speak about the nature of Brahman. And of course, it cannot be, the right knowledge and bliss cannot be identical and different both. Because in that case also, since it is also different from Brahman, although it is identical and different from Brahman, yet different from Brahman, then still the Vedic passage Vijnanam Anandam Brahma should be speaking about the nature of Brahman, and also the nature of, and also the right knowledge and bliss, which are other than Brahman. So therefore, there is the problem again occurs, that the Vedic, great Vedic passages lose their Akhandartha Nishtatva, or the nature of speaking only about the nature of Brahman. Further, the stand that the great Vedic passages speak only of the Brahman is very well testified. Even the idealistic school in the Upanishads as well. Sri Vyasatirtha quotes a Shruti passage here. Ekadaivanudrashtavyam ityadyekarasya Shruti virodhaccha. Ekadaivanudrashtavyam is a Shruti passage which says the Brahman has to be always known only by his nature. Only by his nature, intrinsic nature, and not by anything else other than him. So he should be rightly known for his nature and not anything apart from him. This has to be known. So therefore, if Vijnanam Anandam Brahma is speaking about things which are other than Brahman, that is right knowledge and bliss, it goes against the Shruti passages, which speaks that the Vedic passages or the Upanishads speak only of the Brahman. It goes against that. So therefore, that cannot be accepted. But how is it related to the concept of Vishesha here? That is very well related to the concept of Vishesha, because the only alternative left is, we have to accept that right knowledge and bliss is the very nature of Brahman. It is identical with Brahman. Right knowledge is Brahman. Bliss is Brahman. That has to be accepted. So how is Vishesha related here? Shri Vaisnava points out finally here that with the concept of Vishesha, I mean the power which makes even identical things seemingly have the connotation of difference. Seemingly. That has to be invoked here. Why? Because since right knowledge is missing the very nature of Brahman, if not, there will be many difficulties. Tachadnanam aparyayatvam katam. The question would be, if there is no Vishesha, the power to give that connotation, then how can you say, when right knowledge and bliss is the nature of Brahman, why are they not synonymous? When we use Vijnanam, Anandam, Brahma, we very well grammatically and semantically know that these three words are different, and yet they are speaking about identity. Vijnanam, Anandam, Brahma. There is no synonymous representation of the words here. So, if we want to assume that Pari Vijnana, Ananda, Brahma are not synonyms, and yet they are speaking of identity, they are not synonyms, but yet they are speaking of identity. So, here in Vishesha concept has to be invoked and it has to be accepted. And moreover, Padantara Avayartyam, if right knowledge and bliss is nature of Brahman, it would have been suffice to speak of only right knowledge or bliss. Since it is identical with Brahman, when many things are identical, I mean seemingly many things are identical, it would be suffice to say any one thing there. So it would have been suffice to say Vijnanam Brahma or Anandam Brahma or just Brahman, Brahma. What was the necessity to speak all the three words? This has to be explained only by Vishesha, where the Vishesha operates in case of identity and makes the use of all the three words without being synonyms. And moreover, Vijnana Ananda Yoho Ekatara Aparishesha. Moreover, if Vijnana, right knowledge and bliss is nature of Brahman, since then Vijnana and Ananda also should be one in the same. Since Vijnana or right knowledge is Brahman, bliss is Brahman, then right knowledge and bliss are one in the same. If that is so, it would have been suffice to say any one and not both. What was the necessity? So here again, Vishesha concept has to be invoked. Further, Brahmadishtanatvina Chaitanya Bhanepi Mokshaiva Idani Ananda Prakasha. Moreover, one more important concept is Brahman is held as Swaprakasha in the Hedonistic school. He is always evident and known, both intrinsically as well as externally also. He is perceived as an adhishtana or substratum for superimposition. For example, when we perceive a shell as a silver or the rope as a snake, the element of shell is perceived in some way and the element of rope is perceived in some way, without which there would not be any superimposition at all. This is very well accepted in the Bhagavati and other texts also. So therefore, in some way, the substratum has to be seen or has to be known, without which there cannot be any superimposition. We don't superimpose anything upon things which we don't see at all. That doesn't happen. In which case, there should be chaos of illusions. So, we have to accept that there is a substratum which is known, and that substratum is Brahman. Even in case of a mundane superimposition like the superimposition of the silver, the substratum is not just the shell, but the Brahman who is delimited by the shell. Shukta Vachana Chaitanya. In case of the world, empirical experience, it is the actual Shuddha Brahman who is the substratum. He has to be known in some way. But the question is, when he is Swaprakasha or self-luminous, he is known intrinsically as well as the substratum of superimposition. When he is known, how is it that we are not gaining liberation? Because the moment we get the knowledge of Brahman, we should be getting liberation according to the idealistic school. But however, we are not getting liberation or we are not procuring liberation now. How is it possible? Even though we know Brahman, so who is self-luminous, we know Brahman as a substratum. How is it that we are not gaining liberation? So there, the concept of Vishesha has to be accepted that even though the Brahman is known as self-luminous by his self-luminous nature, and even though he is known as the substratum, but still he is not known in the way to produce liberation. He is not known in the aspect to produce liberation. So this particular aspect is invoked by Vishesha. So even though a particular thing is known as substratum or being self-luminous, It is not known in as with the aspect of liberation, aspect of actual liberation. Therefore, the concept of Vishesha has to be invoked here, since Brahma is identical and without any features or parts or aspects. So, to explain both the illusion and selfness of Brahman together with the concept of liberation not procured right now, the concept of Vishesha has to be verily accepted. So, in this way, and pointing out even many more logic and scriptural passages, Sri Vyasatirtha points out that the concept of Vishesha has to be accepted by all schools of philosophy and even the idealistic school of philosophy, and that concept of Vishesha is a very unique contribution of Sri Madhvacharya in the world of philosophy. It is very well evident and useful both in our mundane empirical experience and also in our philosophical pursuit. For example, when we taste a sugar, the actual substance of sugar and the sweetness are actually identical. If they are inseparable, and yet it is its quality, then in that case we have to accept that there is identity. However, we also say the sugar has sweetness. There is a connotation as if there is a difference, seemingly. And that has to be explained by Vishesha in the mundane level. At the philosophical level also, even though the Lord is one and the same, Vishnu is having many forms and incarnations. But here, even there, in the incarnations of Rama and Krishna, we seemingly make use of two words. We seemingly refer to him as Rama and also as Krishna with two different words. This is because there is the power of Vishesha which makes us use those words, although they are not synonymous, but again referring to an identical person, and there is no difference, intrinsic difference in Lord at all. That is very well primed in the Shruti, Neha Nanasti Kinchana. So therefore, the concept of Vishesha is very vital, both in our mundane experience as well as at the philosophical level. And such a concept has to be very well accepted, and it's very consistent logically. And that is the unique contribution of Sri Madhvacharya, and that is further elaborated by Sri Jayatirtha in his Nyayasudha. And finally, Sri Vyasatirtha makes it completely formidable for anybody to question, and therefore the concept of Vishesha has been very well established in the Nyayamrita. And Sri Vijayatirtha adds many vital points here, as we have noted in the Nyayamrita Lagva Moda, and the concept of Vishesha is very well perfected, and it's a very rich contribution to the Indian philosophy. And we feel very blessed by the great seers Sri Madhvacharya, Sri Jayatirtha, Sri Vyasatirtha, and Sri Vijayatirtha for imparting us this knowledge of philosophical truths and this concept of Vishesha. And here I would end this short lecture on the concept of Vishesha. And I pray Lord Sri Narayana, who is the indweller in Mukhya Prana, I pray Sri Vyasatirtha, Sri Vijayatirtha, and all the great seers for blessing one and all with philosophical truths and enlightenment. Kaginamacha, Manasindirva, Madhyatmanava, Pratyaswabhavat, करोमि यत्र चकलं परस्मै नारायणाय इति समर्पयामि श्रीमन्मध्वेशार्पणमस्तु श्रीकृष्णार्पणमस्तु श्रीव्यासराजो विजयते।